Welcome, welcome, welcome to content check number 4 of the Renaissance section, Unit 1, AP European History. I'm Miss Duncan, and let's go ahead and get this started. Content check number 4 is really going to focus on figuring out how is Northern Renaissance different from the Italian Renaissance. This is going to be centered around the North's relationship with God, so pay close attention to that. Let me see, who are the major Northern Renaissance people? This is going to be a lot of artists and a lot of writers, so pay particular attention to them. I'm going to be a little bit easy with you on the first test that's coming up pretty soon in class. Usually a lot of the Northern Renaissance questions come up when we get into Unit 2, so I kind of clump the Northern in with Unit 2 tests, because it just seems to work out in our timeline a little bit better. So, we will eventually compare those Italian versus Northern writers, and to what extent, and this is kind of an extra question down here at the bottom, in what ways and to what extent did women participate in the Renaissance? You're going to use a Mr. Stipp video that is currently online. If you go to my website, and instead of going to Daily Homework, you go over to AP Euro Resources and Duncan's YouTube videos, then the Women in History, or the Women in AP Euro and the Women in Renaissance video is already up from Mr. Stipp, and you can take a look at that. It basically runs through everything that you need to know for this content question. Alright, so Northern Renaissance. Essentially, you're talking about any place that's not Italy. It's Italian versus Northern. And so, please keep that in mind when we're talking England, France, Spain, Germany, Flanders. That while Spain is just to the west of Italy, it's still considered quote-unquote northern, because it's not Italy. So why Northern Europe? City populations grow rapidly after the plague, and Flanders is going to be one of those major cities that you need to pay attention to. As we've talked about Flanders before, we talked about that back whenever we talked about the Hundred Years' War, and their wool trade with England. So they're a port city. A port city, and anywhere you've got a port city, you've got lots of trade, lots of things happening. They usually become pretty important parts of our European history class and what's going on there. So they've got that long-distance trade, and we've also got growing monarchies. One of the major things we're going to see with the Northern art versus the Renaissance art is the people who patronize the arts change. Since Italy is special with its Italian city-state configuration, it's going to be a little bit different where the patrons are paying for things. So everywhere else where they've got monarchies, growing monarchies because of nationalism, then the patrons of the arts are usually going to be kings and queens. So what would you expect kings and queens to pay for when it comes to art? ? If you said pictures of themselves, well then, hey, you are on the money. So in England and France, we have growing monarchies, and there's going to be some merchants in here. It's not like they're totally gone, but they will be the main patrons of the arts. What makes the North special? Whenever we get into literature, there's a new type of humanism that crops up. Down in the Italian city-states, we had civic humanists. Civics, of course, if you remember back from civics class, you were learning all about government and things like that. Well now, that actually makes sense, because they're talking about things like, what kind of government should you have? And Castiglione's writing about how to be a proper Renaissance man if you're going to hang out at court. Once we get out of that area, then we start to get into a different kind of humanism, and that's Christian humanism. And this is going to be one of the main differences. We'll see it in the art, we'll see it in the writings, this idea of what role is God playing in our lives. So Christian humanists sought to combine humanism with deep Christian faith, devotion to God, encourage Christian reform, and social justice. So we're going to see a lot of artistic themes where we're talking about social justice. Thank Bruegel and his peasant pictures of peasants and common people, in order to bring awareness to what it's like to live the average life of a peasant person, or a common person, and then church reform. We've already talked about and seen with our Renaissance people Erasmus, who got away with criticizing the church. He was a member of the church, and we'll talk about him a little bit more later, but he's going to get away with this church reform idea. And the Northerners are more focused on Christianity. Christianity came a little bit later to the North. My source for this is going to be that Princeton Review book, if you picked that one up. The Northern folks come into Christianity a little bit later. It spreads a little bit, it takes a little bit longer for Christianity to spread there. So they're still struggling with their questions of faith. And this is also going to be the area where this struggle eventually leads to the Reformation, the breaking away of Protestants from the Catholic Church. And we're going to talk about how all those religions spring up. Remember my analogy in class where we were talking about Christians. There are all kinds of Christians. There's different kind of flavors in the candy bowl. You may have different, got different kind of candy in there. They all believe about getting into heaven a different way, but in the end, they're all still Christians because they believe that Jesus is the Son of God. We've also got, as far as artistic themes, oil painting is going to be the main medium, or things that they use to paint with. Main medium up in the North. There are a few sculptures. Durer is going to bring back, Albrecht Durer is going to bring back the woodcut and kind of really perfect that method. But a lot of the artwork is going to be oil paint. So whenever you're coming up with examples for the test, oil paints by Bruegel, oil paints by Vermeer, Rembrandt, they're all going to paint with oil. Artistic themes, peasant life. We've seen this with Bruegel and the Peasant's Wedding, because they want to show that social injustice. But there is a note here, and it is all in yellow. Although religious faith was stronger in the North, it's not necessarily a common theme in some of their artwork. And that has a lot to do with the fact that down in Italy, you've got Rome. You've got Renaissance. The Pope being a major patron of the arts during the Renaissance time. So lots and lots of Renaissance religious art, even though there's more of a focus on secularism. Playwrights, they lump William Shakespeare. He was going to be towards the end of the Renaissance, but they do include him as well. William Shakespeare will write with deep understanding of human nature. So again, getting into that individualism, that humanism aspect. Major players up in the North. You've got your artists. We've talked a little bit about them. We've seen Durer. We've seen Bruegel. Some new to us will be Holbein, Van Eyck, Vermeer, and Rembrandt. I'm actually going to spend a little bit of time talking about them more towards the end of this after the content check, so kind of stay tuned. After the content check flashes up on the screen, I'll take you through a few more of those painters, Holbein, etc. Patrons of the arts, Queen Elizabeth I up in England is going to be a major patron. You saw that, how she brings the arts, and not just arts as far as painting arts, but also playwrights, etc., into the mix. And yeah, that looks exactly like what you would think it would say. I've heard many people pronounce that word underneath patrons. Fugers, Fugiers, there's tons of different ways I think people try to get around saying it, and I think that the right way isn't actually Fuggers, but it helps you guys remember. Everybody likes to say, who were the Fuggers, or what the Fugger was that? I understand that that's, a funny way to say that, and so we'll roll with Fuggers. That's not a problem. Just make sure that you're aware of who you're talking about the Fuggers with. If you're talking about the Fuggers in the back of your parents' car, it might land you in a little bit of a hot spot. So I'm not going to bail you out here. If I get phone calls about the Fuggers, I'm going to tell them that I told you that it's pronounced Fugers. So I guess you'll have to deal with that one on your own. But be careful whenever you're talking about the fuggers in mixed company. Writers, Erasmus Moore, Rabelais. Rabelais was in an original Renaissance people assignment that I did. I don't deal with him too much because he's sometimes put on the test. This is going to be one of those instances, and you're going to hear me say this a lot. It means the difference between getting 79 questions right versus 80 on the exam, or missing one on the exam. You have the opportunity to go out and find out who Rabelais is. He's on historyteacher.net. He's in plenty of review books. He's going to be a main major player of the Renaissance as well. We talked about Cervantes over in Spain, writing about Don Quixote, and Shakespeare, I think you guys are pretty familiar with. We also have an inventor's column, Gutenberg. Make sure you know what he invented and how important that was. So when we talk about Bruegel, this is, of course, the peasant's wedding. We've seen it in class, that idea of the common people and helping folks understand what's going on with the social classes in this time period and pointing out some of those social injustices. I like to ask you guys in class, who's the bride? Where is the bride in this picture? And see what you guys come up with, so you'll be prepared for that. We talk about this in class. This is a guy named Vermeer. Vermeer. So take a look. We have the girl with the pearl earring on the right. And I think that's the water pitcher on the left. Since these are in the north, the medium is going to be oil. And this is where my theory that frescoes are vibrant kind of comes into question, because it's maybe a little bit of a different kind of vibrant. Vermeer does lots of yellows and oranges. If you see yellows and oranges and chiaroscuro, like on the right, then consider Vermeer as a very good choice for your answer. And to me, these almost look very vibrant as well, but I think they have a lot. That has a lot to do with that chiaroscuro effect on the girl with the pearl earring there. But notice, this is not religious. It's more just everyday common people, which is a common theme up in the north. Here, another common theme in the north is kings painting, having paintings of themselves done. This is done by Holbein the Younger. There is a Holbein the Elder. This is Holbein the Younger, and can you recognize that king there on the left? If you said Henry the Eighth, well then, nice job. Nicely done. That is actually Henry the Eighth. He's got some pretty particular things that he usually does that kind of point him out as Henry the Eighth that we'll talk about a little bit later when we see more of Henry the Eighth's individual portraits. Henry VIII there again on the right-hand side, and that is a picture of Sir Thomas More whenever he was Henry VIII's chancellor. That's why he's got that fancy bling jewelry around his neck. He is one of the main people in charge of running Henry's government. Usually these are also going to be religious figures, people of the church. In class, and this will actually be after our first exam, we're going to compare the Italian Renaissance writers, Machiavelli's The Prince, Castiglione's The Book of the Courtier, with Erasmus's In Praise of Folly and Thomas More's Utopia. So if you kind of want to get a head start on that, take a look at what each one contributed to the Renaissance. Like, what was the point of The Prince? What was the point of The Courtiers? Not just the basics, but also kind of the big picture overall effect. Same thing with In Praise of Folly and More's Utopia, and try to see, you know, what do the Northern Renaissance writers have in common with those Italian Renaissance writers. Here's your content check number 4. Like I said, please stay tuned. I'm going to talk a little bit more about some of the artwork from the North. All right. So, I like to do this a lot in class, but we may not actually have a chance this year, so I'm going to speak about it with you right now. Italian Renaissance, versus the Northern Renaissance. Again, both of these pictures are done in oil. Look at Da Vinci's Mona Lisa in 1503 versus Vermeer 1665. You're talking about over 150 years of change here, and the techniques. We've got Fumato, of course, on the right with Da Vinci. Chiaroscuro over on the... flip that. Mona Lisa's on the left, and the girl with the pearl earring on the right. The girl with the pearl earring is considered the Mona Lisa of the North because of that the mysteriousness she's got, her popularity. Also, and just kind of a fun little bit of a story there, and you can look this up on Wikipedia, too, if you want to double check. Whenever this was originally written, it's called The Girl with the Pearl Earring. The Girl with the Pearl Earring. So that was supposed to be the focus, and that was the intent of Vermeer, was to draw focus to that earring. But she had to be restored a few years back, and when they restored her, the pearl earring has ceased to be the focal point. I don't know about you, but there was one piece of this girl's face that I saw that was the first thing I saw when I first saw this picture, and it sure was not that earring. So maybe the earring was the first thing you saw, I don't know, but whenever they restored her, the earring was no longer the prominent feature of this painting. So talk about somebody completely changing an interpretation and an artist's point of view. It went from the pearl earring to something else, all because one guy did a little bit of a restoration. Rembrandt's Night Watch is an awesome, awesome painting, and they like to use it a lot on the AP Euro test. The copy that I have in the back of the room just really doesn't do this justice. You can really start to see a little bit more the building behind these people. If you look towards the right and in the back, you've got a building. There is a crest. Let me see if the mouse will point to it. There's a crest, a building crest on the side of that building there. So you can kind of see how they decorated. This is, of course, up in the north. It's in it's actually still displayed in Amsterdam. That's its hometown. And this is done, like I said, by an artist named Rembrandt. So next time you're in the toothpaste aisle, see if you can find Rembrandt's name. But it's done in 1642. It's oil on canvas. It is Dutch. And Mrs. Jessup isn't around anymore, but I've got a few of you who had her last year. So if you can talk about this to your peers, if you had Mrs. Jessup, definitely talk to everybody about this, because she's actually been to see this in person. But again, you can see the chiaroscuro effect, that sharp dark versus lights. There's a main focal point in the center of the painting where one artist or one of the people is a little bit lighter than everyone else. Notice the way the people are dressed. There's also another figure that is all lit up in this painting, so there are two of them. So my question to you before we talk about this in class is, what are these people doing? What time of day is it? What do you think is about to happen? As you look at that and as we talk about it, hopefully in class, we'll talk about it at least once in class. If not now, then definitely during our art week at the end of the year. But those are some questions to ponder between now and then. Renaissance legacy, again, a break from that medieval idea, and this is overall, not necessarily just in the North. More secular ideas, it's prompting this democratic idea, the civic humanists. Greco-Roman styles are reborn. The printing press is going to revolutionize technology at this time period, and literacy rates are going to skyrocket during this time. So more vernacular literature, not everything's going to be written in Latin anymore. And that's where we get into the importance of Dante's, Dante, when we get into Chaucer. Also a book called The Decameron by Boccaccio. So take a look at those and make sure you understand how information is spread around at this time. Humanism focuses on individual achievement. It isn't just about surviving and toiling through life so you can get into heaven. People are now wanting to be better people, either through civic humanism or Christian humanism. But that idea that I am now an individual person, not just we're all in this together, the church tells us what to do, one collective people. If you think about it, there should be a natural progression. If people start valuing the individual and the person, that means a person has value. If a person has value, the next logical step is going to be that if I'm a person and I have value, I have individual rights. But I'm foreshadowing a little bit, getting ahead of myself. There's all kinds of other artists and portraits and painters that you might want to pay attention to, especially if you're shooting for a 5. It's worth your time to go back and double check either the Awesome Sheets or a review book talking about Titian. Titian is strongly regarded in the Spanish court. There's a lot of his artwork in Madrid at the Prado. Again, you can see, obviously, the classical themes. You got cherubs running around. Europa is, now you're getting into ancient Greek, classic Greek, ancient Greek and Latin and Roman time periods when you get the idea of Europe as a classical figure. Salome, again, getting more into some into biblical times. And there you have it. So thank you for tuning in, especially if you've been diligent and you have watched all 4 of these videos. I greatly appreciate it. I am hoping that you will see where all this fits into your test. And in the future, I plan on incorporating a few more things into the videos that will also be a little bit of a heads up for the test, so that it really is going to be worth your while to sit here and listen. So thanks a lot, and best of luck on your first AP Euro test.